hard as this might be to believe, this fly shop is the highest grossing fly shop in the Bass Pro system. We're the only ones that do fly fishing classes. Without further ado, this is Eric. My name is Jeff, and we both work in the fly shop. Both of us have been fishing for longer than most of you have been alive. We're retired from various things. I was in telecom and computers, and Eric was in the technology industry. We do this because we love it, not because of the huge amount of money we get paid or the career advancement. We are not here to sell you stuff. We're here to teach you about fly fishing. We want you to enjoy the sport and get a good start at it. So we're going to spend about an hour in here talking about some aspects of it. Then we're going to go outside with some fly rods, and we're going to teach you how to use that 9-foot piece of graphite, all right? So if you ever have questions during this get together, just raise your hand and ask it.
There are no dumb questions.
And there are no dumb questions.
Okay, so this is a beginner class. I'm sure you guys have tons of questions, so ask away, okay?
Well, and you know, in that same line, the guys that we work with back in the fly shop, we're here for fun, okay? If you have a question, I don't know how this works, I've heard about this and I don't know anything about it, come on into the store, we'd be happy to tell you about it. You know, that makes our day. You know, if you don't come in and ask us about fly fishing, then we have to do other stuff like put stock out and, you know, help people in footwear. So, first things first, fly rod. Fly rod is a varying length, but usually 9-foot lever. And that lever is used to cast a fly line. It's not used to cast a fly, it's used to cast a fly line. Now, the big difference between angling, as I'll call it, and fly fishing is you're casting the line instead of the lure. So when you're casting a lure with a spinning rod or bait casting, it's the weight of the lure that carries that lure and that line out into the water. When you're casting a fly, you're casting the line, and it's the line that carries that fly out into the water, okay? So the motion's different. How many of you used a spinning rod, bait casting rod, okay? That's the motion, right? That's not what we do in fly fishing, and that'll be the hardest thing for us to get you over, is to break that habit of flicking your wrist. When you're looking at fly rods, when you come back to see us and say, hey, I'm thinking about getting into fly fishing, the first things, three things we'll tell you is you want a 9-foot, 5-weight fly rod that's medium fast, and the amount of money you spend will not determine how many fish you catch, all right? So you can spend a lot of money on fly fishing gear, and you can spend a little bit of money. It has nothing to do with how many fish you catch. By the way, we're going to have some smaller, shorter rods for some of you smaller, shorter people, because it'll be a little easier for you to get the hang of it, okay? And you may want to start out with a shorter rod, okay? It'll be a little easier for you to handle and work your way up to a 9-foot rod. Now, 9-foot, 5-weight rod is the Swiss Army knife of fly rods around here. Okay, now if you're like Eric and fish a lot in Florida and salt water for big fish, you're gonna maybe use a heavier rod. What do I mean by heavier? Rods come in weights. So there's 1 weight up to 16 weight, okay? 5 weight is not quite in the middle, but it's close, okay? 16 weight is a heavy, heavy rod. A 1 weight is a very, very lightweight rod. Now, in fly fishing, we have a numbering system that we've designed to confuse people to keep the riffraff out, okay? In rods, reels, and line, the bigger the number, the stronger it is, okay? In leaders, tippet, and hooks, the bigger the number, the smaller or weaker it is, okay? So a 16-weight rod is heavier than a 5-weight rod, but a 22 hook is tiny compared to a 12-hook, size 12-hook, okay? We'll address that a little bit more. So, what in the world is a medium-fast rod? Well, rod speed is a little bit subjective, wouldn't you agree? But we have kind of a real simple way of doing it. I'm showing you the wrong way to put together a fly rod. Anybody notice anything wrong with this? So one of the things, you know, Eric told you there's no dumb questions. You're also going to learn that there's good ways to do things and bad ways to do things, or better ways to do things, I should say. You just saw a good way to put a fly rod together, but there is a better way, okay? The better way is, start at the tip, one section at a time. Now, it's not dangling behind you and maybe at risk of breaking. Okay? So, there's a good way to put it together like I did the first time, and then there's a better way. Now, rod speed. If you hold a rod by the butt of the rod like this, and you see it bending maybe from a third of the rod up to the tip, that's a medium fast rod. And there's variations on that, but by and large it's medium fast. A slow rod is going to look like this if you hold it by the butt section. And a really fast rod is going to look like that. It barely bends the last foot, you know, of the tip. Why does that matter? Well, we'll demonstrate this out when we get outside, but when you're throwing the line back and forth, the weight of the line, either going back behind you or in front of you, is what's loading the rod or bending the rod, okay? And that when that rod bends, you're putting power in that rod. When you come forward and stop, you're unleashing the power of that rod into the line and shooting it forward. Now, a medium fast rod loads at a certain pace and unloads at a certain pace, which is easier for most people, including people like us who have been fishing a long time, to get the rhythm of. A slow rod loads really slow, and you get impatient and you go forward too quickly. A fast rod loads and unloads so quickly, if you're not right on it, that line can come right back and hit you in the back of the head. So, the rods that you're going to be practicing with later today are all medium fast rods.
Unless somebody wants to get hit in the head with a hook, does anybody want that? I can. Yeah, you do? Okay. All right. We can arrange that.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, it's kind of healed now. But see that? If you haven't been hooked, you haven't been fishing. All right. So that's a medium fast 9-foot five weight rod. That's what I'm holding in my hand. That's what you're going to be using later, and that's what we would recommend you have if you don't have one already. Now, the next thing is the reel. Well, I'm going to talk real briefly about reel, and I'm going to turn lines over to you, okay? When you're buying a 5-weight reel or smaller, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, it's a line holder, okay? It's there to hold the line when you're traveling, when you're, you know, moving from one location to another, when you're done for the day. You are rarely, around here, going to battle a fish with your reel, okay? Now, when you start moving up and start getting up to where Eric fishes, you know, get with tarpon or big fish, or I've been known to catch a pike with my fly rod, you will battle the fish with your reel, and you will want to make sure you've got a good functioning reel. But when you're starting out with a 5-weight, the rod is more important than the reel. The line is more important than the reel, okay? Now, I'm going to turn it over to Eric, and he's going to talk a little bit about the line system and what is made up of the line system, or
all right,
what
guys,
makes
so
up the line system.
Jeff talks about a 5-weight rod, okay? 9-foot, 5-weight is your typical. That's a 9-foot, 5-weight rod with a 5-weight reel, okay? And the reason you want to match up your reel to your rod is so that it balances out, okay? You can go a little bit lower, you can go a little bit higher, okay? But typically, you're gonna want a 5-weight reel, okay? That in turn means that you want 5-weight line, okay? You want to match your rod, your reel, and your line. Because if you get heavier line on a lighter reel or on a lighter rod, what's going to happen? You're not going to be able to do anything. It's going to be like swatting at flies. If you get lighter weight line on a heavier rod, what's it going to do? It's not going to do anything, right? It's just going to flop around like in the wind. So on a 5-weight reel, you're going to get 5-weight line. This is a 12-weight reel, okay? This is what we use in the ocean, okay? You use 12-weight line. You can obviously see that this is what we call the arbor, okay? This big section in here. You're gonna see that larger arbors require heavier line, larger line, right? Now, when you're putting line on a fly rod or on a fly reel, you're going to have, where's my backing? You're going to have what we call backing, which is basically, this isn't really backing, but basically backing is string, okay? So before you put your fly line, you're gonna put backing on your reel. Now on a trout rod, like a five weight, when you're going for smaller fish, not the bigger ones, the backing doesn't really matter. The backing is just taking up space on the arbor, okay? So it's just making sure, because usually fly line is about, you know, anywhere from 90 to 100 yards, right? Or feet, sorry. So you can fit a lot of line on something like this, but you can also fit a lot of line on something like this. So if you only have 100 feet of line, you're only gonna take up about that much of the reel, right? So we put what's called backing on there, and backing is string. Now, if you're fighting a trout, typically you're fighting that trout by stripping it, right? So the backing, you're never gonna get into your string, okay? Question?
Yeah, I just wonder why that's always on there. Why is there so much?
Because if you don't have any backing on your, okay, so you've got this arbor right here, right? If I only have this much line on the arbor, what's gonna happen when a fish goes to take it, right? It's gonna go all over the place. It has way too much room to move around in this spool, okay? So we put the backing on to allow that line to come out evenly, so to speak. Does that make sense? So if you didn't have, plus we don't want the line to slip underneath. So line is very, very slippery. It's almost like, you know, like plastic stuff. Whereas the string sticks to the arbor, right? So we don't want anything slipping underneath so that the spool gets all messed up. And then when you get that trout on the line, you can't get him in because your reel's not working.
So in that sense, it's completely different from a bait reel.
Correct. You don't have any backing on. I mean, and if you do have, if you're using like a bait caster, you have a little bit of backing on it so that the spool doesn't slip, right? Because if you're thumbing it, and that thumb comes up, then it's gonna start spool from the backside too. Does that make sense to everybody? So on a spin rod, you're not worried about that because the mechanism controls the line, right? On a fly reel, there's nothing to control this but you, right? So you're actually holding on to that. So the backing is just taking up space on the spool, okay? Now, if you're going after bigger fish like pike or muskie or tarpon or sharks or barracuda or whatever, those fish run, okay? They run and they jump and they do all kinds of things. So the backing actually matters. Now that string is a little bit stronger than the string that we would put on a five weight reel, okay? Because when that runs, they take 100 feet in a matter of seconds, not a matter of minutes. So by that time, we're managing that fish on the reel, not with our hands and the rod, okay? So the backing matters there. So you're gonna get fish into backing, but then you're gonna control the fish with your reel and your rod. Whereas with trout, you're controlling it with the rod and your hand, okay? 9 times out of 10, when you catch a trout, if you're doing it correctly, the time that you have to hold onto the trout with your hand, the line in your hand, and getting that line on the reel, the trout's gonna be gone. And if you get a trout running far enough on your line on that string, what's gonna happen? If you catch a fish on a piece of string, what usually happens? It snaps, it breaks, it's string, right? Okay, so when you're talking about line, there are hundreds of different types of line. It's designed, once again, to confuse you all, okay? So if you come in and you go to a reel fly shop and you say, look, this is what I'm gonna be doing, I'm gonna be fishing for trout, typically it's 9 foot, 5 weight rod, we're gonna put a 5 weight line on it, and you don't need to get into the $100 and $150 line sections, okay? Typically line for a 5 weight reel or a trout rod is gonna be anywhere from $40 to $80, okay? There are two different kinds of line. There's weight forward and there's double taper. You don't need to concern yourself with either one of those, okay? Because you're not gonna know the difference between a double taper line and a weight forward line. So if you come into us, we're gonna tell you exactly what you need to put on there, and then you're obviously after today gonna know how to use it. Did you have a question, boss?
Yeah, so do you get to keep the rod?
I don't think so. No, you do not. No, you do not get to keep the rod today.
Depends on how well you do casting.
Okay, so does everybody understand the whole idea between the line and the backing and the reel? Okay, on a reel, you have what's called a drag system, Okay, everybody always talks about, well, my 9 foot five weight reel has a great drag system. Who cares? The drag system basically locks down the spool when it's spinning. Okay, so when you're reeling the fish in, the drag system is the pull that fish is able to have. Okay, but when you're fishing for trout, they don't really run, they don't really fight. They go and try and hide, and they go and try and break you off. So 9 times out of 10, you have to have the line on the reel in order to use the drag system anyway. And like we're gonna teach you later on today, when you're fishing for trout, you've got line out. And when that trout bites, you set the line, but you're setting it with your rod and you're holding on to it with your fingers, okay? It's not on the reel. So the drag system means absolutely butt-kiss, all right? So that's when Jeff was saying this is really just a line holder, that's really all it is, because you're controlling that fish with the rod and your hand and the line. Okay, does that make sense? Okay, so we got backing, we've got line, and now we've got leader and tippet. Now leader and tippet, this is what the line looks like when it comes in this box. You say, this is the line I want, I'm gonna attach it to the backing, I'm gonna put it on your fly line, or on your fly reel, okay? After that, you have leader, which comes like this. Now, like Jeff said, this is a little bit confusing, okay? Because when you get into leader and tippet and flies or hook sizes, the higher you go, the less strong it is, the thinner it is. Okay, so if I'm fishing a 9 foot 5X or 5 weight rod, I'm probably gonna fish a 5X leader, okay? And you're gonna see the 5X right here, you're gonna see what the poundage is, and as you go up in the leaders, you're gonna see that poundage go down because they're not as strong. Now, if you go to a 1X leader, is that heavier and stronger or lighter and thinner? Anybody know?
Heavier.
Heavier. Heavier and stronger, very good, okay? Now, when you get leaders, they come in either 3-packs or singulars. At the end of every fly line, okay, this is the fly line, this is the leader, God bless you, okay? At the end of most fly lines, there's a loop, okay? That's because every leader comes pre-looped. So it's a lot easier for you all to do a loop-to-loop connection, and we'll show you how to do that, than it is for you to tie some crazy knot from your leader to your line. Plus it allows them to charge you about $6 more for that little loop, okay? So they're like, oh, let's put a loop on, it'll be convenient. And we'll tell everybody how convenient it is, and then we'll charge them an extra $6. These are not cheap, okay? A 3-pack runs about $14, okay? Now, so you've got your loop on your fly line and you've got your loop on your leader. This is what the fish, this will actually lay in the water. This is so the fish can't see how that fly is attached to your fly line, right? It's clear, it's monofilament, it's pretty strong, okay? When you get these, they're gonna come pre-looped like this. Now, I know I said they make the loop for your convenience, they do this just to mess with you, okay? When these things come, they come just like this, and if you don't unwrap them correctly, you just wasted $4, okay? So, when they come like this, you're just gonna unwrap them. See this little loop end right here? Everybody see that? Mm-hmm. Okay, you're gonna take the loop end and you're just gonna unwrap it like this. Usually it's wrapped about 5 times, okay? You're gonna unwrap it like this and you're gonna keep. Now, if I don't unwrap this correctly, what's gonna happen is I'm gonna go to straighten out that leader and it's gonna have knots in it, which makes it absolutely worthless, okay? The trout have a hard time seeing this, but if there's something in it that makes it not act the way that it should, they're gonna be able to see it, okay?
And also, knots in monofilament weaken the monofilament.
Correct.
So a 5X leader is about 5-pound test, if you wanna put it in fishing line terms.
Yep.
Okay, well, if you put a knot in that leader, it's now a 4-pound test.
Does that make sense? So we take this loop, and we take the loop on the line, and we feed it through the loop, and we'll show you how to do that in a little bit, okay? Then we get this out. Now, can you fish it like this? I mean, you could, you're probably not gonna catch any fish, right? So you gotta straighten the leader, okay? Because these leaders do have memory, all right? So you're just gonna, you can use what Jeff does, which is his little, this is just 2 pieces of leather. It's called a leader straightener, and you can just put the leader between here, and you can just run it like this. Or you can just use your hands, okay? It burns a little bit, okay? But then I'm gonna straighten this out all the way down. Okay.
If I can add, just running it through your fingers or the leather doesn't do it, you've got to squeeze really hard.
Yeah. Okay, now when you have a leader, we're going to put this in the most general terms. You have a fat end and you have a really skinny end. Does everybody see the difference between these two ends?
Yes.
Fat end goes to your reel, goes to your line. Skinny end is where the bugs go. Okay? Now you can see that it goes from fat to skinny, right? Here's the fat end. It gets skinnier and skinnier and skinnier and skinnier and skinnier. And then to about right here is what we call the tippet end of your leader. That's the skinny part. Okay? Now the skinny part is where you put the fly. Now, we only have a certain amount of skinny part. Okay? So when now remember, this is a $4, $4.50 leader, right? So what happens when I run out of the skinny part? Because I can't, like he said, I can't tie a fly on the fat part, right? So I either have to get a new leader, which is $4.50, okay? Or I can tie tippet, which is, remember the skinny stuff, I can tie new tippet, which looks like this, onto my leader. Now, for you beginners, that's gonna be difficult because it's a pretty significant knot, okay? So it may be easier just to replace the leader until you've gotten yourself comfortable with tying certain knots, and we'll talk about those knots later, okay? But anyway, you can add tippet to this line, and that way you're spending $3 on tippet as opposed to $4.50 on per leader, okay? So the tippet part is where the flies go, and Jeff's gonna give you his little entomology lesson. Does that make sense? Everybody understand what part of the leader goes on the line, right? There's the loop. And then this is the part of the leader that goes to the fly. All right? And if you're changing flies every time you're fishing, there goes a little bit of that, then there goes a little bit of that, then there goes a little bit of that. So if you're doing it right, you can probably get, you know, 7 or 8 flies out of this line before you have to replace it. Okay? Yeah.
So what's the standard length on a
9 foot. So basically you're gonna
get to about. Can you always start out with flies on the leader?
Yeah, I always do. I mean, you're gonna get old timers that are gonna tell you, you need to add another 12 feet of tippet to this in order to do it. You don't. The way that they are designed these days, they are designed to put flies on them. Yeah. I mean, that's the way to go. Now, as you get closer up here, obviously, it's gonna get easier and easier for the fish to see. But yes, these are tapered specifically to put flies on.
I'm sorry, you said those were about 9 feet.
These are not, well, there's 9 foot and there's 7.5 foot.
So initially, it's not called backing. It's gonna
your fly back. Line.
My fly line's gonna come
all the way through here. Yeah.
Yeah, but it's when I reel up for the day and mm-hmm. I move down the river, it's
you're gonna have some leader in there. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. That's just kind of my indicator.
Well, if I can add one thing. Generally, you want your leader to be the size of your rod. So if you're fishing with a 9 foot rod, you want a 9 foot leader. If you're using a 7.5 foot rod, you want a 7.5 foot leader. Now, as Eric was saying, you're tying flies on, you're gonna burn up some of that, what we call the tippet portion of the leader.
That's the skinny part.
Okay. So once you burn through that, at what point do you tie it on? It's a judgment call. When you start to get to the 4X part, which is thicker,
right about
you're gonna wanna add some 5X. But you may want to add 5X earlier, or you may want to change to a smaller tippet size for some reason. But generally, you want your tippet and leader to be about the length of your rod.
So you've got about 3-4 feet of tippet on this leader, okay? So basically, anything, and honestly, anything after 3 feet, I'm probably replacing the leader, or I'm tying tippet on there.
I'm sorry, after 3 feet?
After 3 feet of using the tippet end of the leader, I'm risking the fish being able to see what's going on, right? So and the other thing is that the sizing system on the leaders and the tippet is exactly the same. Okay? So if I'm using 5X leader, which is basically 5 pound test, when I'm adding extra tippet, do I want to go to 6X tippet or 4X tippet? Anybody know? There's no wrong answer. Well, there is a wrong answer, but I'm not gonna rag on you. Okay. You want to go from fat to skinny. So if I'm adding tippet, I'm either adding the exact same poundage or test, right? I'm using 5X tippet. But if I want to go smaller because the fish are spooky or whatever, I'm going to add 6X tippet. That's because 6X tippet is thinner than 5X. Remember, the higher you go, right, the thinner it is. The lower you go. So if I have a 5X tippet and I add a 4, or if I have a 5X leader and I add a 5 and I add a 4X tippet, I'm going from fat to fatter. Does that make sense? Okay. So typically, if you're fishing, you know, for trout, you're going to use a 5X leader and you're either going to use 5 or 6X or 7X tippet. Okay? Anything 5X or above is for a 5X leader. Make sense? Yeah? Everybody got it? Correct, because it absolutely defeats the purpose. You're going from fat, like I said, to even fatter.
Yeah.
When you're casting a fly line, you're trying to roll that line out. And so the heavy fly line is rolling out, and it's going to roll that leader out. And that 5X monofilament is going to then try to roll out 4X tippet, and it's just going to drop in a pile. Well, I'm sure somebody tried that.
Yeah. No. I mean, no. I mean, typically that kind of defeats the whole purpose of the transfer of power,
yep.
Right? Remember, you're transferring that power from the fly rod to the line, and the line is what's unloading out. So if you're interrupting the flow of energy on that because it's got to stop to go, wait a minute, what is this?
Yeah.
You're defeating the purpose. So remember, always go what you're fishing on the leader to the tippet or higher. Make sense?
Higher in terms of number.
Number, right. Does that make sense to everybody? Yeah? Okay. Now we're going to get even more confusing with bugs.
We're going to do bugs?
Yeah.
Well, first we're going to
load the next thing.
Before you can tie in a bug and before you can get in the water, you've got to string up your reel and your rod. So, remember when we started out, we said that there's a good way and a better way to do just about everything. By the way, fly fishing's personal. All fishing's personal. Should I have a vest or a pack? Eric's going to talk about equipment. Should I have a 9-foot rod, a fast rod? It's all personal. So, just because we said this doesn't mean that's the only way. Okay? You'll find ways. But in this instance, there's a good way. And there's a better way. So one way, I mean, it seems intuitive, is to take the end of your line and start running it up through your guides like this. I don't know why I'm doing this without my glasses. But as you go along and you're out there in the nature and all of a sudden a bug, like a mosquito or something, lands on the back of your neck and you go to swat it, do it. I knew that was going to happen. I was going to cut that off. Okay, well, you get the idea, okay? It's just going to drop back down. So, what's a better way to string up your rod? Okay, grab some fly line. Make a little loop in it. And put it up through the guides like this. Now, this serves two purposes. It's always good to have two purposes. The first purpose is when the bug bites you, it doesn't just fall down, okay? And the second purpose is when you get done stringing it up, you're pretty much ready to go get in the water because you've got your leader and your line pulled through the end guide. Now you want to make sure that you get every single guide and you don't wrap the line around your rod somewhere along the way. And for those of you that aren't 9 feet tall, you just set it on the ground like that. And now, you're ready to get going, okay?
Does everybody know how to get your fly reel attached to your fly rod? Everybody knows how to do that, right? Everybody? It's okay if you don't.
I think I did. No? There's
some trick. No, there's no trick. Well, you got to do it right, but yeah.
Okay. So we haven't really talked about left hand, right hand, but there's left hand retrieve and right hand retrieve. Most people use left hand retrieve. In other words, they're casting with their right hand, retrieving with their left hand. But this is the reel seat here. In here, there's a little slot that it fits, the reel seat fits into. And then there's this ring that slips over it. And then you tighten these screws down, and away you go. Rick, you had a question?
Yeah, when you slap that bug on the back of your net,
yeah.
Isn't that something you also want to see?
Well done.
Yep. Okay. Rick shoots, he scores. All right. So, let's talk about bugs a little bit.
That bend was about 6 feet. Is that what you did? I couldn't really see it that well, but.
What was? Doesn't matter.
But it wasn't like
2, 3, 4 feet. Yeah, more than a few inches. Yeah. See, if you get enough fly line through, okay, it can't run back down the guides. Okay. The fly line's heavier than the monofilament. So if there's only 2 inches of fly line up there, there's a chance it could just fall back down again. And you get to do it again. All right?
Jeff,
so
you got a question?
Yeah.
Why can't you use actual bugs?
That's a good question. I don't know the answer to that. I think primarily two reasons. One is the law oftentimes says you can't use live bait, and a live bug would be, or even a dead bug would be considered live bait. And two, I don't know if you could get a hook through a bug and get it to stay on.
Especially as some of the small ones that you're going to see.
Yeah. Okay.
Some of the bugs
That's
are
a good
really
question,
small.
Though.
That is a good question.
Yeah. So, all right, we call this Swenson's Entomology 101, right? And I'm going to put it in terms that you can all understand since we've got little ones in here, okay? All aquatic insects are born on the bottom of a body of water, whether it's a river or a lake or something like that. They hatch and they become baby bugs, okay? These are baby bugs. You can pass this around. As they mature, now, how long does it take? Literally, it can take hours, it can take weeks, it can take months, it even can take years, where these little bugs are just burrowing around in the bottom of the river and waiting to emerge, and then they rise to the surface and they become adults and they fly away and they find a date and come back and lay eggs and it starts all over again. But the entire time that these bugs are growing and maturing, they're moving down the water column in the case of a river, right? Or they might be moving around in the current of a lake. If you ever go to a river, and you probably will, I think, you're going to see a trout sitting over here by a rock. And every once in a while, it'll kind of dart over here and come back. He went over here, or she went over here, and had lunch. You didn't see it because it was that big, okay? Now, how in the world can trout see anything that small? Well, I don't know. But how in the world can anything with a brain the size of a pea be smarter than us, right? That's 42% of their diet is made up of bugs that size. 80% of their diet, 85% of their diet, is made up of subsurface bugs. So it could be adolescent bugs or toddler bugs. They're in some stage of maturing to adulthood and going to the surface. If you pump a trout's stomach and believe it or not, we sell pumps and we do that, you'll see what they're eating. It'll just be a big mass of those little bugs. Now, as those bugs mature, they get a little bit bigger. Whoop, they start to look like that, okay?
Really colorful.
Some of them are, yeah.
Huh?
Okay.
Does it hurt the bugs? No, typically not.
So,
yeah, not being real.
As those bugs rise through the surface, and there's different species of bugs that are different sizes, they start to rise through the water column, and they start to sprout wings and legs and antenna, and they're still lunch, okay? They're still below the surface. And then they become adult bugs, and they look like this. Now, you're going to recognize, I'm going to pass this around, be careful, these will fall out, but these were... Those were tied by one of our colleagues here, who's an artist when it comes to tying flies. And those are mayfly patterns. But you'll recognize some of these bugs in here as mosquitoes, okay? Or gnats, or mayflies. There's all sorts of names for them, but they're adult bugs. When they get to the surface, they dry off their wings and they're gonna fly away. Now, you have all seen the video of a trout taking a fly off the surface, right? That's where all the, you know, they get all the TV coverage, okay? But where they eat is down below. And if you come by the fly shop, we're happy to talk to you about something called a dry dropper rig or a hopper dropper. Because now with the hopper dropper, you've got two flies on and you're covering the entire water column, okay? If you're only fishing dry flies, you're limiting your chances of catching a fish, okay?
By the way, all of this information is in your packet.
Yep.
All about the bugs, the different kind of bugs, the life cycles, where they are when they begin, where they are when they end. So it's all in this packet here, okay?
Now there's other types of bugs that are not aquatic, okay? Like grasshoppers and dragonflies and bumblebees and ladybugs and ants and beetles. And they fall in the water, especially this time of year. They'll fall in the water from a bush or a piece of grass. And that's also trout food, okay? And then there's other types of, I don't remember what we call them, but essentially they're worms and eggs and scuds. So little tiny micey shrimp, right? So you've probably heard of a lure called a San Juan worm. And somewhere in one of those boxes I passed around, there's a San Juan worm. That's a very, very effective pattern for trout. It's not a bug, it's a worm, okay? But in the springtime, particularly when the runoff and the rains are pushing larger volumes of water down the streams, it stirs up the mud and the sand, and those worms get unearthed and they go floating down the river, okay? Now, when you're fishing with a dry fly particularly, all right, I gotta be careful where I wave this. You're gonna be watching that fly move down the river, okay? If that fly stops for even a millisecond, what happened? Probably, yeah. The current never stops, does it? So if your bug stopped or your strike indicator stops, lift your rod tip, right? Because you maybe have a fish. Now a trout can take a fly and spit it out that fast. So you may not see a big giant tug on, you know, sometimes they feed aggressively, but most of the time they'll put that bug in their mouth. They have soft mouths. And if you don't lift your rod tip up right away, they'll have spit it out, okay? The other thing Eric was talking about, and we're gonna do this outside in a minute, when you're managing your drift down the river, you're stripping line in like this, okay? You're always keeping it under your finger because when you wanna set the hook, okay? Oops. When you wanna set the hook, if you don't have a hold of that line, when you lift the rod tip, it's just gonna pull slack out, okay? So.
Here, I'll be the fish. I'll be the fish.
Oops,
so that Jeff doesn't hit anybody in the head.
Okay. All right. So, if I don't have my finger here.
Okay, this is the end of the line, right? This is where the fish is going to eat.
Okay.
If I eat.
Now, if I don't have my finger here, I didn't set the hook. I just let the line run out. Okay. So you're always managing your line like this. So when now I've got them. Okay, but do you see what I did? I just lifted the rod tip. Okay, this isn't like trying to fish for muskie or tarpon where you're hauling back on it. Okay, it just takes, just lift the tip. Okay, questions? Nope. Okay, Eric's going to talk to you about equipment, and I'm going to go out and get us set up for casting, and he'll get you all rigged up or set up with rods.
This is all just to get you the hang of doing it so you can actually catch fish. So the most important thing we need to talk about is not necessarily gear, but how the gear affects the fish, okay? So does anybody know how fish breathe? How do they breathe? Through their gills. Okay, and when you're breathing, what are you breathing?
Air
or oxygen, right? So trout are cold water fish. Right? Okay. So when the trout are deep, that's where the water is coldest, right? The higher up the water, the warmer it gets because the sun hits it and it warms up, right? So when trout are in the water, they're getting oxygen through cold water, right? So when a trout decides that he wants to eat, and it turns out that you've got something on the other end of that line that doesn't allow him to eat, he's going to fight, right? Okay, so when you guys go out and you run around all day and you know you're playing on the jungle gym or you're playing soccer or you're playing football or whatever you're doing, you get tired, right? Right, and you start breathing heavy, right? Same thing with the fish, okay? When you catch a fish, the fish don't like it. They don't like having hooks in their mouths or in their bellies or whatever, right? So they're gonna run and they're gonna fight. Now, the secret to fly fishing, why most people let fish go, is because it's probably the right thing to do, right? Most fly fishermen don't keep their fish. And if they do keep their fish, they're basically limited to a certain size fish that they can take home and cook and eat, right? But for the most part, when we're fly fishing, we're letting the fish go at the end, right? Okay, so when we catch a fish, fish have what we call protective slime, okay? They have stuff on their skin that keeps predators and other things away, okay? It also keeps them a little bit warmer or cooler depending upon their body temperature. But when that trout runs, he's gonna get tired, right? Okay, if the water he's living in is cold and he eats your fly and you bring him up to the hot water, that's gonna make the oxygen less, right? Does anybody know what water temperature a trout in Colorado, okay, what water temperature is unsafe, or did anybody even know that there is a water temperature that's unsafe for the trout or any fish? Does anybody know? 77? Nope, close, 65 degrees. Okay, so a lot of times you'll see fishermen running around, Jeff doesn't have his on, I don't think, but you'll see them running around with the thermometer, okay? They're not gonna bake a cake. They need to figure out what the water temperature is, right? So if the water temperature is 65 degrees, that means there's less oxygen in it, right? So if a fish decides to eat your fly and it takes off and it runs and it gets tired, it has less oxygen in that hot water, okay? So it's usually between 65 and 67 degrees that you don't wanna be fishing. Turn around, go do something else, okay? Go throw rocks. Run with your dog, do something else. Because what happens is that if you catch that fish and it runs for a long time, or it tires out, it's not gonna be able to get oxygen back in its gills, okay? So if the water is, especially like now, this summer has been crazy because everybody's had to stop fishing on some of the local lakes and rivers because the water started at like 70 at 6:30 in the morning. Okay, so you always want to make sure that you check the water temperature. If you're on a high mountain or you're in the mountains, you're usually okay. Okay, but you always want to make sure that if the water's hot, you don't fish. Okay, now, water's cool, we caught a fish, yay. Okay, I personally, and there's a lot of youngsters here, I don't understand the whole idea of taking pictures of your fish. It makes no sense to me. My wife laughs at me, she's like, did you catch fish? I said, yes. She said, well, where's the pictures? I didn't take pictures of my fish. My fish didn't pose for the pictures. I didn't take a picture of my fish, okay? Now, when you catch a fish, you use your net, right? Now, some of the old school nets are made of fabric. Not only are those bad for the fish, but they're a waste of money, okay? If I get a hook caught in my shirt and I try and pull the hook out, what's gonna happen? It's gonna get tighter, and what's gonna happen to the shirt?
It's gonna rip.
It's gonna rip. So why would you put cloth on your net? Because the minute a hook gets stuck in that, it's gonna rip. So the newfangled nets are made of plastic or polyurethane or whatever you wanna call this, okay? See how there's a lot of holes in this net? That gets water flowing through the net. When you catch a fish, the first thing you're gonna do, remember Jeff said set that hook, right? Then you're gonna bring the fish in on the line. Okay, you're gonna get the fish close enough that you can get the hook out of its mouth, right? So the first thing I'm gonna do is I'm gonna put my net down, I'm gonna hold my rod, or I'm gonna put it underneath my arm, and I'm gonna grab a hold of the leader, okay? The first thing I'm gonna do is I'm gonna get my hands wet, okay? The reason I'm getting my hands wet is because I don't wanna take that slime off of that fish, okay? I'm not gonna reach down and I'm not gonna pick up the fish and I'm not gonna squeeze it. If you hear a fish making a sound like, that means you're choking. Okay, don't do that, Okay? Don't pick up the fish. Don't try and dig in it with its, you know, with your forceps or whatever. All you gotta do is wet your hands, bring that fish, get your net underneath the fish, and bring that fish into the net. Okay? If you want to take a picture of the fish, take a picture then. Have somebody out. You can go like this if you want to be in the picture. Okay? Once the fish is in the net, then you can control the fish. You don't have to reach in there and grab the fish. You can control the fish right here. Okay? There is something that just came out called a catch and release. This is a newfangled tool that some genius came up with, and he's made a lot of money doing it. So instead of the old school way where you open up that fish's mouth and you grab these little forceps and you dig down into the fish's mouth and you pull out that hook, remember, fish have really soft mouths. And a lot of times if they're eating those baby bugs that you guys saw, they're way down in their gullet, okay? So 9 times out of 10, you're probably not gonna be able to get that fly back, right? So if they've gutted it, cut the line. It's a $3 fly, okay? If it's stuck in their mouth, this little thing is magical, okay? And what this does is, everybody see how there's a little slit in there that you can slide a hook into?
Yeah.
See that?
It'll slide right in the line.
Yep. See, everybody see that little slit that's in there? Okay. All you gotta do, see it? Okay, all you gotta do is just hold that fish in your net, see? Then you take this little tool and you slide it down the shaft of that hook and you pop it out. It's really that easy, okay? This is a great little tool to have. Everybody has one. This is probably the only thing that we talked about today that we actually have, that we actually carry here, okay? But, and that, well, we do carry the $300 nets if you're all interested, but that's basically what you're doing. So I'm managing that fish in my net, right? And if he doesn't have a whole lot of place to run, right? So I can just grab him here, I can hold him, I can push this in the net, and I can pop out the hook, okay?
What's that called?
This is called a catch and release, okay? It's made by Fish Pond. There's a couple of different ones out there. Yes, ma'am?
And if you're worried because you're catching bigger fish with teeth,
correct.
They make longer.
Correct, they do. They make longer ones than these. Fly. Yeah, for like muskie and pike and things like that, yes.
Piranhas,
yes. Okay, so now once that hook's been taken out of that fish, we got to get that fish ready to go back, right? You don't want to just let a fish go once you get the hook out. You know, you see a lot of people that go like this and they try and get the hook out of the fish and then they throw it back in. That fish is probably going to die. Okay? So once we got the fish out of the hook, we roll them around. Now, why would we roll them around? How do they breathe again? How do they breathe? How do fish breathe? In their gills. So you got to get that water moving back and forth in the gills so that fish can recover. And then all you got to do is just go like that. Okay, let him out, keep an eye on him for like 3 or 4 seconds afterwards, make sure he doesn't swim out there and then go, okay? And that's that simple, okay? You guys gotta really be careful because if you're on a catch and release stream or pond and a ranger walks up and you didn't unhook that fish correctly and it dies, you're getting a ticket, okay? So you gotta be, and it's just the right thing to do. They're animals just like us. If you had a hook in your mouth, would you like somebody just pulling on it? Probably not, right? Okay, so make sure that you're doing that. The other component is etiquette, okay? Fly fishermen can be mean and nasty. Hopefully none of you will be, okay? When you're walking up to a stream, okay, and you see someone fishing in it, okay, most of the time fly fishermen, if they're fishing streams, are gonna be throwing upstream and drifting downstream, okay? So you don't wanna just walk in right underneath where that guy's fly is gonna end up because you're scaring away all the fish, okay? Check with him. See if he's going to be walking upstream or if he's moving downstream. If he's in a lake, don't just walk in front of him or behind him, okay? When you get to the stream, okay, and pay attention to the bugs. Pay attention to what's around you. Like he brought up, if you get bit by a mosquito, that probably means there's mosquitoes out there on the water, right? Look at the water. Lift up a rock. See what's under the rock, okay? But don't do it and then chuck the rock back in while someone's fishing over there, because they're probably going to be angry. There are all different kinds of fly fishermen. I'm going to try and put this the most politically correct way I can. There are a lot of gentlemen and ladies that think that if they're in the river, they own it. The bottom line is that you figure most people are casting between 10 and 15 feet. Okay? That's how much line they're using, and then they're drifting. So if you think of 15 feet on either side of that angler and probably behind them, you're probably going to be okay. My opinion is that you just simply ask them. Say, hey, partner, which way are you headed? Do you mind if I jump in, 20 yards upstream? Just ask them. And if they're mean, then you can chuck the rod. No, I'm kidding. You can't chuck the rod. If they're mean, go somewhere else. Okay? But there are a lot of old school fishermen that don't like people around them. And that's just unfortunate. Okay? But the bottom line is that you need to be respectful to them. You need to be respectful to the fish. And you need to be respectful to the environment. So if you guys are going up fishing and you see a Coke can and a Lunchables wrapper and somebody's tire, you're probably not going to pick up the tire and carry it out. But whenever you go in, whatever you bring in, take out with you. And I carry a bag in my pack that I just put stuff in because people litter all the time. Okay? They do not take care of our water and our wildlife. Okay? So just keep that in mind. When you go in, pick up and take everything that you see that you can when you leave. Okay? Okay. All right, who wants to go outside and cast? Oh, yeah. I figured. Some of the kids are getting ready to fall asleep. All right, so what we're going to do is we're going to give each of you guys a rod. When you're carrying your rod, am I going to carry it like this?
No.
Why?
Because it could hit something.
It's going to hit something, yes. Okay, so typically when I'm carrying my rod, I'm carrying it like this. So if I hit something, it's going to bend this way, right? So we're going to take these rods, we're going to walk out this door. Watch out for the person behind you, okay, when you're carrying it like this, because I've been hit more than once. All right, we're going to walk out these exit doors right here, and we're going to go over to this side of the building. Okay, each of you guys is going to get a rod. You want to hold on to it, and then we'll walk out the side of the building, and we'll get started. Does anybody have any questions about anything? We'll talk a little bit more when we get back in here.
The most important part of fly fishing is casting. Okay, so you can have the right bug, the right rod, the most expensive reel, the fanciest outfit, the coolest waders, the neatest hat. And if you can't present that fly properly, you're not going to catch any fish, okay? So learning how to use a fly rod is very important. And using a fly rod has one fundamental aspect of it, that once you master it, you can do anything. How many people took piano lessons? Okay? And you got to do the scales, right? Or anything else. In anything, there's a fundamental and there's a part of it that's not any fun because it doesn't look cool. And this is the part we're going to do, right? Remember, at the very beginning of class, I talked about the fact that the hardest thing for us to get people to get over is flicking the wrist, okay? This motion, fly casting motion, is very simple, okay? Here. To here, here to here. And if you think of, all right, you haven't taken music lessons, how many know what a metronome is? Tick, tock, tick, tock, grandfather clock, tick, tock. Okay, it's exactly even. If you've got 30 feet of fly line out, how long does it take to go that way versus that way? It's the same. So you can't go tick, tock. It won't work. Tick, tock, tick, tock. So around here, you're going to see a bunch of cones, and I'm going to have you guys step back a little bit that way. Okay. This drill is designed to help you get the feel for this process. Okay. Now, if you watch the line and watch my wrist. You see what I did? I stopped. Okay? When you do that, what you're doing is loading and unloading the rod. And when you unload the rod, that line goes straight. And if the line goes straight, you did it right. If the line doesn't go straight, like that, you did it wrong. And the only way to get it straight is to accelerate to a stop, accelerate to a stop, accelerate to a stop. Okay? Once you get that motion, we're going to have you climb the wall.
okay? Now, do you see that my rod tip never goes past those yellow cones? Not like this, okay? This, like that. Tick, tock, tick, tock. It's very simple, but it's but it can be hard. So, grab a set of cones somewhere, and we'll come out and help you pull some line out, and we're gonna work on that drill, all right?
Guys, if you get the line out, and for whatever reason your reel isn't moving, raise your hand and I'll come and I'll adjust the drag.
Okay, you got it figured out? Here, let's. Okay, that's loose. So grab a hold of that where the red is and pull some line out. There. All right, now I want you to stand right here. I want you to stand right here. Okay. And you're going to go whoop, boom. Okay. All right, so how are we doing? Okay, and you can stand right over there and point your rod tip here.
Okay. And
you're going to hold it here. Okay. I should have said this earlier. For those of you that aren't familiar with rods, how do you hold your rod? Shake hands with it. Okay? With your thumb on the top, shake hands with it, just like you'd shake hands with somebody.
Look at him, already got the motion. Use your arm.
That's pretty good. Now, here's what I want you to do. I want you to come back here. Whoop. And I want you to go like that and stop.
She's got it. Have you fished before?
No.
No? All right. Guys, don't whip it. It's not about power. It's about loading and unloading. Loading and unloading. It's not about power. You don't have to move it fast. It's about one way and the other way. Using your arm, not your wrist. If you're using your wrist, it's going to hurt after a while.
Okay. Do it this way. Well, don't go at him. If you stand over here, and you can cast up the line, okay? So you're pretty good. You're pretty good. You are pretty good. You know how to do pick up and lay down?
What?
Pick up and lay down?
What's that?
Okay, so when you've got your flies on the water, right? And you're gonna strip it in as it goes down the river. Now you gotta pick it up and lay it back down again and run that slack out. See where the slack is? There's no slack anymore. See?
Yeah, okay.
Okay, now pull some slack in. Get it under your finger. Okay. Now let the rod load behind you. Okay? Give it a minute to load so it lays straight out. All right.
And then it lays out again, just like that. Don't hurry it. Yes, just like that. Now don't hurry it. The line's got to load and unload. Okay. And as you're doing that, then you can try and go up a little bit and see it, but you want to keep that line parallel to the ground. So as you're going up, there you go. Keep practicing that. All right. How we doing, boss? Okay, here's what I want you to do. I want you to tuck it in like this. Keep this arm nice and all I want you to do is I just want you to go like that and like that. See how you're moving your arm, not your wrist?
Yeah.
Just like that. That's all I want you to do. It's just practice just like that. Okay?
Okay?
Can you do that? It might be a little heavy for you. If we need to get you a lighter one, let me know. There you go. You got it. Okay. So, guys, keep in mind that you're drawing a straight line with that rod. You're not doing this. You're not doing this. It's a straight line with your arm. So all you're going to do, all you're doing, we can face you here. It's just this. See how when you go like that, the line loads and unloads?
Mm-hmm.
So all you're gonna do is just get it, practice getting that motion down and see how I'm using my arm and not my wrist? Because if you start using your wrist, it's gonna do all kinds of crazy things. So just nice and easy, keep your arm and the shoulder down and just nice and easy. Get it used to that line going all the way out. And then when the line goes out, you're gonna go back over here and let the line go all the way out there.
Okay?
Okay, good. All right, you're using your wrist. You guys gotta stop using your wrist. Use your arm. So keep your shoulder down, that. Keep your shoulder down like that, and you're just doing this. Load, unload. Load, unload. See how the rod stays? You're just drawing a straight line. So I want you to get used to when that line goes out, then you move it and you let the line go out that way. But keep this arm in, okay?
Ben, slow down, bud. Okay? You hear that snap behind you?
Yeah.
Do you know what that is? You know what the sound barrier is?
Oh,
the line, the end of the line is breaking the sound barrier because you're going around, you're whipping it around and going back forward so fast, the line has to break the sound barrier to catch up to come around, and that's what that snap is. You don't want that because it'll snap your fly right off. So when you're doing this, Ben, back, forth, back, look at my line. You see what it's doing? Okay?
You need to get used to doing that. Let it load, let it unload. See how I'm drawing a straight line with the rod?
Yeah.
And the line's going out every single time? That's what I want you to practice.
Okay?
Hold on to it like you're shaking hands.
And the line as well?
Yep. Hold on to the line and then just boom, boom, boom. Not with your wrist though, with your arm. Okay? Keep your arm bent. Relax. Loosen up. Boom, 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 boom. Feel it?
Yeah.
Okay, keep practicing that. How we doing, guys?
So go blue to yellow.
There you go. You got it, dude.
No wrist though, remember?
Yep. Keep that nice and tight. Here, I'll show you. Nice and, is it heavy? It's pretty heavy, huh? Okay, hold it back here for me. Okay, nice and easy. And then try and just do boom, 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 boom. Just like that, okay? See how when you stop the line, the line goes out, stop the rod there. But just use your arm. Just boom, 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 boom. Okay, not your wrist, because your wrist is gonna end up hurting. So do it like this, okay? Yeah, like that, yes, like that, do that. Not so fast, nice and slow. Let it go out, now let it go back. Let it go out, let it go back. Draw a straight line like this, straight line. Slow down. Okay, straight line just like that. Okay, just keep drawing the straight line. Okay, good job, dude. All right, partner. So do that again. Do what you just did. Okay. What I want you to do is when you do that this next time, I want you to follow the line and tell me what the line's doing. What's the line doing? It's dropping, right? So what do you think that means? Watch when I do it. Does my line hit the ground? See how my line stays in the air? That's why we want you to do this, because you got to get used. See how when I go this way and I stop it, the line goes out? And when I go this way, the line goes out like that when I stop it? Same concept back here, right? The line has to stay up in the air. If I'm using my wrist, what happens to the line? It drops, right? So if I use my arm, see how the line stays up, right? So that's what I want you to try, okay? Just shake on it. Just shake it like you're shaking hands with a, turn your hand, there you go, like that. Don't use this, use this, okay? Use your arm. Not so fast, don't jerk it, nice. Look at your line, what's going on with your line? Folks, the line doesn't lie. If the line is dropping, then you're not doing it right, okay? You want the line to continue in a straight line with the rod. Okay, better, do it again. Okay, now go ahead. Do it again. Okay, now what I want you to do is I want you to take that concept and I want you to transfer it, stand straight, and I want you to do this. See how the line is staying parallel? Don't use your wrist. Mm-hmm. See how the line is staying parallel to the ground? Okay?
Okay.
Nice and easy. Give that rod the time to allow that line to do what it needs to do. Okay? Don't use your wrist. Use your arm. Okay? I'm going to walk behind you real quick. Better. Good. Better. If you guys are having a hard time understanding what the line is supposed to do, turn around and watch it. If the line drops, you're doing it too slow. If the line whips, you're doing it too fast. Okay? You got it, Bubba.
You're not giving the line enough time to load the rod because you're coming back again before it's gotten all the way out there.
It's a fun little rod.
See the whole thing.
Exactly. Yeah.
Can you watch my cat?
Sawyer, how you doing? Let's see you. Let's see what you're doing, okay? I'm gonna pull a little bit more line out. Hold on. Okay. So, tell you what, Sawyer, can you stand right over there and put your rod tip on that white line? Stand right here. Attaboy. All right. I want you to like this and stop at that blue cone. Okay. So let's hold the rod down a little further. There you go. Okay. All right. So now I want you to go like this and then like this and like that and like that. Okay. Like you mean it. Okay.
Shake it like you're shaking its hand. Just like that. Just like that. Okay, now do what you did. Go ahead.
Put your left foot out.
There you go. Yep. Go try it. Okay. Okay. Now what I want you to do is I want you to pretend there's a fish over there. What are you going to do? So what you're going to do is you're going to go boom, boom, and boom. You feel it?
Mm-hmm.
Keep this rod nice and tight to your arm. Boom, 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 and boom. One, two, three, and down. You feel it?
Mm-hmm.
Try that. One, two, three, and down. Yes, dude. Yes. Do it again. One, two, three, and down. Yes. Do it again. One, two, three, and down. Yes. Do it a little bit faster this time. One, two, three, and down. Good job, dude.
When you finish that last cast, have your rod tip be pointed right in the direction of that fish.
Yep. Good. There you go. And you can even bring it up a little bit if you want to. You can bring it up in the air a little bit more if that feels better. Got to go a little bit faster. Remember, you want to draw a line straight across above the pavement, okay? So one, two, three, and go. Do it again. One, two, three. Yes, dude. Very nice. Wow. We got a kind of a natural here, don't we? Very nice job. Keep practicing that. Not so fast. It's not about fast. Remember, yes, yes, do that. Yes, good.
Not this, not this, right? And so that's what that drill is, to get you to get that motion of tick, tock, tick, tock.
When you go slow, the line drops in the water. We don't want it to drop in the water, so try and get it up a little bit higher, okay? There you go. There, dude, yes.
What's your name?
Kai.
Kai? All right, I have a nephew named Kai. Let me see you throw that thing back and forth a little bit. All right, Kai, do it like you mean it. Not farther, just firmer. That's better. Okay, now you can climb the wall. Let me see you get it up in the air.
She won't use her wrist anymore. She's got the timing, she's got the action, but this is gonna start to hurt after a while. So try and keep it in here as much as you can. Here's another way. When you hold it, for whatever reason, the ladies, a lot of times the ladies will hold it like this, for whatever reason. So I'm literally, look at my line, see my line? See how the line doesn't drop? And then when I wanna go, I just point where I want it to go. One, two, three, and down. One, two, three, and down. You see me?
Yeah.
Okay, try either one.
All right, watch. How far is the rod tip going?
Not far at all.
How far is the line going?
Pretty darn far.
Okay.
Okay.
So now the rod's doing the work. Okay, wait, no, wait. What's the rush?
Okay. Too much.
Okay. I'm exaggerating, but, and I'm not making fun of you, all right?
Good.
But it's just a nice, smooth, fluid motion, okay? See how slow I'm going? Okay? That's the point. There's no, Tony? What's your name?
Tony.
Tony.
Yeah.
There's no Tony. We need Rod, no Tony.
Okay.
Okay? So more rod, less Tony. Okay? How are you doing?
I'm doing okay.
Yeah? Let me see.
I would go out this way. Do you want to go this way?
You can go this way, yeah. Okay. What's your name?
Lindsay.
Lindsay. Okay. More rod, less Lindsay. And slow down. So just what I was showing Tony, okay? Watch, see the rod, how long it stays back here? Okay, once you start whipping that thing around, I'm exaggerating, but you see, you've taken all the power out of the rod,
right,
and you're just trying to, you're hoping it goes somewhere. But see, if you do it this way, back, forward, and then you lay it down, look at how far it went out, see? And I didn't do anything. And if it doesn't feel like you're doing anything, you're probably doing it right, all right? So work, remember, tick, tock, tick, tock, tick, tock, slow. Slow and steady wins the race.
Okay. Boom, boom, look at the line, yes. You're right, do it, you're fine. Watch, if the line's not gonna lie, if the line drops, you're doing it too slow, okay? Do this. Don't let this hat fall, okay? Cast like you're fishing. Okay, better, do it again. See how you're using your arm, not your whole body? You're just using this. That's what you want to do. Okay? Do it again. Nice and easy. Yes, yes, that's good. And down. Do it again. One, two, three, and down. Good. Do it again. Keep doing that, okay? How we doing, guys? You got the timing down, dude. So now I want you to do, don't use your wrist, keep that arm tight, because when you're using that arm, here's what I want you to do. I want you to do one, two, you got too much line out. Let me see.
Oh.
You're all right. Okay, so now what I want you to do is I want you to do one, two, whoop, one, two, three, and down. Okay, point your foot where you're fishing. One, see how my line stays parallel to the ground?
Yeah.
See how it's not taking a lot? Okay, let's bring in a little bit more. One, two, three, and down. Okay? That's what I want you to do. Go ahead.
Tuck. Tick. Get that rhythm, okay?
So, like, are you gonna bring it this far?
Yep.
Okay.
But do it like you mean it. Okay, you went all the way back, and you never let it load. Stop. Ooh, that was close. Do it again. Stop. Go. Hey! Like that. Way to go.
See my line? See how it's staying parallel to the ground?
Yeah.
Okay, that's what I want to do. I don't want to do this because this is too slow, right? So I'm going to scoot up over here a little bit, and I'm just going to do one, two, three, and down. And what happens is that when you stop that rod, one, two, three, you stop it here, and then I want you to follow it and point wherever you want that line to land.
Yeah.
Okay? Mm-hmm. All right, do that. How are we doing, guys? Oh, he's got it. It's all right. Let me see, boss. Can I see it real quick?
Hey, you okay?
You all right?
Yeah, what's up?
All right. So let's do this.
No, we're still.
Okay, come here. Let me see. Let me see what you're doing.
What?
Okay, show me.
Oh.
Here, go this way.
Yeah,
let's go this way. One, two, okay. Keep this. Come all the way back if you can. Come all the way back. There you go. And I want you to put your thumb on top here. Okay? And I want you to do this, just like this. One, two, three, and boom. One, two, three, and boom. See it? One, two, three, and boom. Okay, practice that. It's gonna be hard for you because that rod's big. Get it up in the air a little bit, Bubba. There you go. One, two, three, and down. Good job, dude. Do it again. One, two, three, and down. Okay, bring it up in a little bit now. One, do it up.
Okay.
One, two,
let that line
three.
Load.
Good, do it again. One, two, and three. Good, one, two, three, and down. Okay, now try and, now what you wanna do is point it up a little bit. And just go one, two, three, and down. One, two, three, and down like that, okay? How we doing, boss? You doing all right? You trying to hit me? No, I'm just kidding. Okay, let's bring this in a little bit. Okay, go ahead and do it. Let me, show me what you got, Bubba. Okay, do it again. Okay, hear that? Did you hear that behind you?
Yeah.
Why do you think it's whipping? When I do it fast? Hear that?
Some of you are maybe feeling frustrated, like you're not getting it, and some of you think you got it, and you're all probably right at some level, okay? This fundamental, this tick-tock, that acceleration to a stop, is fundamental to almost every kind of cast. And that's why we start with that. I know it's not the fun, flashy part where you get to wave the line in the air, but one of the things you're gonna learn is that there aren't any fish up there. The whole point of casting is to get your fly in the water, right? Once you get your fly in the water, it's gonna drift down with the current, right? And you wanna make sure you take any slack out so you're bringing that line in so that when you hook up, you lift your rod tip, you're setting the hook, right? Okay? Now, how do you get back once your line is over here? How do you get back over there? Well, remember the tick-tock? So, you're gonna pick your line up off the water, back, forward, and it shoots the line out for the most part, okay? So you're coming over here like this, up, and, oh, that was terrible. Okay, there we go. See, the slack's gone. Now, if you do it right, and for those of you that are wondering, we all don't do it all right all the time, okay? It's okay. Don't be so hard on yourself. But once you master that tick-tock, tick-tock, you're back down, okay? If you're doing this, all you're doing is scaring the fish. The only reason I'm having you do this exercise is I want you to, if you all look at the rod tip, how far is that rod tip moving? Okay, it's not going back here, and it's not going down here, it's just up here. So master that move, and now when you go back to your cones, I want you to work on taking a little slack in, picking it up to 10 o'clock, back, forward, and shoot that line back out. Okay? That's called the pick up and lay down, and that's a key.
With you, it might be kind of hard to do what he was saying, because it's hard for you little guys to do it, but I want you to keep practicing what you were practicing before, because you got it down. All right? There you go.
Put a little 5-year-old in front of you to have whip it around, right?
All right, go ahead, buddy. Now, what happens if there you go, dude, do it again. A little bit fast, watch that line. There you go, do it again.
Look at your target when you're finishing up.
Now remember, we're using our arm, right? Not our body, there you go. A little bit faster, do it again. One, two, there you go, three and four. One, two, three and four. Good, make sure you end up pointing that rod right exactly where you want it to go, right? Right? Good. Try and get it up a little bit more in the air now. There you go. Oh. How we doing? Do it again. Let me see. You just did it. It's not weird. You just did it.
Oh, so that's fine?
Yeah.
Oh.
So all you're doing, come over here a little bit. Stand right here. All you're doing is you're just, so if you take slack out, right? If you do it right, that line, so if I pull this slack, Like, watch, if I pull, watch, if I pull all of this slack out, watch what happens. See, that's the line doing what it needs to do. So all you're doing is you're just pulling a little slack in, you're going one, and you're going two. And if you get the motion right, the line's gonna go all the way out the way it should. Does that make sense? Okay, try it now. There we go, nice. Remember what that, remember that rod, it's 10 and 2, bring it, so watch your line. When you do this, look up at your rod tip. Tell me what's going on.
Ooh.
Yeah, so you gotta go 2, 10, 2, 10. Don't use your wrist, you're using your wrist. Okay, let me show you something. Put your arm down.
Okay.
Don't let this hat drop, okay? I want you to use this arm,
mm-hmm.
and I want you to do your 10 and 2. Do it. Yeah, buddy.
That's all.
Now, don't do wrist. See, you're using your wrist again. Keep this. Keep this. Turn your hand like this. I want to try something.
Okay, Ben. Patience. You got a lot of line out, okay? It's going to take a bit for it to go back, and in order for it to go straight back, you're going to have to do it like you mean it, okay? And then bring it forward. But doing it faster doesn't help you. Okay? Not bad. Oh, wait. Okay. Now, remember what we were talking about with the line? Okay, or the rod? Where's my rod? No, where's my rod? Where's it pointing? Okay. And that's where your rod is, okay? Stop it here, okay? So if I put my arm up here, can you, okay? Now go back, go forward. Now go back like you mean it. Now go forward, okay? Go back like you mean it. Forward, back like you mean it. Don't cock your wrist. Just, instead of reaching out and doing this, get your arm in here, because you've got a good arm strength. What did I hear? Yeah. But give it some time, okay? Give it some time. You're going to be a good caster. Here's the thing, Ben. What I want you to do, okay, when you go back, okay, when you throw that thing back behind you, okay, stop. Okay? You're not stopping hard. You're stopping soft, so you're ending up with a falling loop. See that? Okay, so see how my line stays almost vertically or horizontally in the air? Okay, and I have as much line out as you do, and I have the same rod as you do. Okay, keep it up in the air, and the way to do that is to keep your rod up in the air. Okay, all right, so how are we doing on pick up and lay down, Chuck? Well, except there's a lot of chuck in there, not a lot of rod. So when you pick it up and lay it back down again, okay, it hardly has started going back when you start forward and you're throwing it with your arm and a little bit of body English, right? Okay, so just back and forward. There we go. So there, now you got it. Now you got it. There. Okay, now look at it. Good job. All right.
But here's what I want you to do. All you gotta do is just the line that's there, right? I'm just gonna take a little bit in like this, right? Watch what happens. One, two. Pull it in. One, two. See how the line goes, the line loads out? One, two. That's all you gotta do, okay? Do it one more time, yeah? But see, you're doing all wrist. You're all wrist. Don't do wrist.
It takes as long as it takes, right?
Well, like in still water.
Well, in still water, like a lake, that's a good question, okay? The answer to that question is, in still water, trout are not sitting, waiting for lunch. They're circling, looking for lunch, okay? So depending on how big a lake or how big a circle they're patrolling, you might want to leave it out there for 10 or 15 minutes,
okay? Because they're just slowly swimming along, waiting to see if I can find a bug. Because the bugs aren't coming to them because it's still water, right? So if you throw it out there, now depending on what you throw out there, like if you throw a grasshopper pattern out there, you might want to give it a little bit of a, just a little jerk every once in a while to, you know, give it a little action to attract attention. But you want to give it 10 or 15 minutes because you may have missed the, you know, you may have just thrown it out there and the trout just went by, so you got to wait for them to come back.
That's all I'm one. See how the line, doesn't matter how much line you have out, it's all about keeping the line parallel to the ground. And if you're using your wrist, and if that's something that you're struggling with, go get, you know,
like
the, when
a
you,
wrist,
thing. Yeah, like a wrist guard. And it works, I swear. So just see how my wrist, it's not, I can stand on one leg, dude. It's not that hard. It's just one, two, three. One, two, three, and down. Okay, try that. Keep your arm, keep your shoulder in. Yeah, you got it, boss. Watch the line. What's happening to the line right now? Watch your line as you're doing your loop. See it dropping?
Yeah.
Okay. What? Why is it dropping?
It's up to the loop.
Yep. And you're not going slow. You're not going fast enough. Okay. So just one. Nope. You're going back too far. Okay. This is the area where you want to stop your rod. So stop and start your rod where my arms are. Watch the line, not wrist. I can tell you're using your wrist just by what the line is doing. Nope. You got to keep this in here.
Okay.
Now go. Look at the line. Watch the line. The line doesn't lie. Look at the line. Yes, dude. Do it again. Okay, you're stopping it too late. There you go. Now, watch the rod on the line. Just watch the rod on the line for a few. See how it's you're bringing it back over here because you're wristing again. You got to stop using. Oh, hold on. You're caught. Yeah. Bring in more line. Bring in a little bit of line. Nope, not out. Bring it in. You still don't have that timing down. Do it again. No wrist. See the line? See how the line is bunching up?
Yeah.
That's because you're not moving it fast enough and you're stopping it too short. That. Look at the line now. See what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But you're wristing it still. Don't wrist it. You gotta, all right, now try this.
Kind of like I have to bring it out a little bit.
Well, yeah, but you don't because let go. So I want you to try holding it like this.
Okay.
Okay? And I want you to just, when I'm using my wrist, it's not working. You gotta get the whole rod moving with your arm.
Okay.
And then I just point where I want it to go. Okay, try that. Don't use your wrist. You gotta consciously not use your wrist. You're using your wrist again, I can already tell. Yeah, no. Yeah, like that.
Okay.
Okay, do it. Better, do it again. Better, do it again. Yes, see? Watch your line. It's not about hurrying it. You guys are gonna get tangled up. How we doing, boss? You got it, Bubba. Okay, so what I want you to do is I want you to go, hold on to it like you were doing. Hold on to that, yeah. Ready? I want you to go boom and let it go. Okay, boom and let it go. Okay, that's what I want you to do. How we doing, boss?
I think I'm all right.
Show me. Okay. Okay, here's what I want you to do. Take off your hat. Put your hat underneath your armpit. Don't let that hat drop. Go. Keep that arm down. Use this. This is your lever. Not this. Not this. This is your lever. Do it. Nah. Now watch your line. What's happening to your line when it goes in the behind you? Watch your line.
I'm not.
No, just watch it. Just watch it when you do it. Go ahead. Okay, that one was pretty good.
Yeah.
See, you don't want that line to drop, but you want it to run parallel and then out. Okay, do it again. Good job, bud. Good job. Yes, like that. Yes, like that.
Hey, that's not bad, William. That's not bad. Hey, how you doing?
Good, how are you?
Good. Less Angela, more rod. Okay? So let the rod do the work. Okay? So if you watch my rod tip. Okay? There's no me in that. It's all the rod. but you've got to get the rod a chance to load up, and then you can unload it, okay?
Yeah.
Okay, that last one, you had it, you had the rhythm right, Angela, but that last stop and then lay it down. Don't pound it into the ground, okay? That won't help it. Just let the rod unload and then lay it down. And it took most of your slack out, okay? See, if I take all this slack in and I do it right, see? The line, I unloaded the rod, the line shoots out, and then you just lay the rod down so the line lays down quietly, okay? All right, you got that part down pretty well. How you doing on the pick up and lay down?
Good, I think.
Good, you think?
Yeah, so what's that?
All right, so when you can take a little bit more line out.
And
then, there,
yeah,
okay.
Yeah, like that, I've been good at that. It like lays out really well.
So, you know, what you're gonna do is stop and unload the rod and then lay it down, right? Stop, lay it down. See what it did with the slack? Took it all out. Okay, let's, yeah, take, rip some off of there. Now, what you can do, what you're doing now, okay, with a false cast, you're using, see how the line shoots through my hands?
Yeah.
Now I'm getting more line out, okay? And that's what a key part of a false cast is to let more line out. So get this under your finger or in your left hand. Now, when you go back, you're holding on tight. When you go forward and you unload the rod, you let it run through your fingers. Let me see you do that. Okay. Oh, look at that. With the pick up and lay down, now what you're going to do is take that slack in, pick it up, back, forward, stop, so the line shoots out, and now it lays straight out. Okay? Tony. You ever watch the Olympics?
Sometimes.
Women's gymnastics, rhythmic dance. They got the ribbons.
No.
All right, well, take my word for it.
Okay.
Don't do that.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. Click. Oh. Tick, tock. Tick, stop. Tick.
Oh.
Tick,
stop.
Tick.
There we go. Show me again. Okay, good. You don't need to have this much line out. You got it, dude. I mean, you know what you're doing. What I want to do now is I want to see. So you've got this, right, where you're doing this and you're doing that. Now I want to see you pretend like that blue cone right there is a fish.
Yeah, that's why I'm casting.
Is it? Okay, good.
Yeah, I'm trying to
trying to get it to that. Okay, show me.
Yeah, that's why I was in my line.
Okay, two. Watch your rod, watch your line. Now watch when you go out, when you go back, watch what your line does. What's it doing? It's dropping, isn't it? There you go, dude, do that again. You don't need any more line. Leave the line where it is, do it again. Yes, like that, do it again. Yes, like that, do it again. Yes, see how it's not dropping? See how I went it, and now it's going exactly where you want it to go, right? Do it again. Yes, dude, do it again. Yes, do it again. Yes, you got it, keep doing that. Not with your wrist, with your arm. You were doing it with your arm before. Yes, like that. Do it again, not so nice and easy, nice and relaxed. Do it nice and relaxed. I'm gonna hold your arm. Yes, like that, do it again. Not your wrist, your arm. Not back so far, remember. Nice and easy, yes. Nice and easy, don't use your wrist. Yes, that's much better, dude.
Okay, you're just going back and forward so fast that that's what you're ending up with. Okay, remember tick, tock, tick, tock, not tick, tock, tick, tock, tick, tock, tick, tock, all right? Oh, all right, dueling fly lines, I love it.
So if I'm gonna use my left hand, if I'm doing this, watch the line behind me. Okay, the line doesn't have any power to it. You gotta do it with your arm. You gotta do this. See how the line is staying parallel to the ground? Okay, one, You got. If you watch the line, I'm doing this with my left hand, which is weird. If you watch the line, it's got to stay parallel to the ground. I don't care if you're right here. You don't have to keep the rod straight like this. You can turn the rod with your arm. Okay. Did I tell you to try this? Try casting like this. See how I'm pointing? See the line? Watch the line. If the line stays parallel, then it's going to go where you want to go. So try holding it like that.
Okay.
Okay? Try that. Yes! Faster. See the line? Look at the line. See? That's what you're supposed to do. That's the way it's supposed to load and unload. So for whatever reason, some people just respond better to doing it that way. Do it again. Yes. Yes. Plus, it doesn't let you use your wrist as much. Do it again. Not your wrist. Arm. Arm. Yes. Do it again. Uh-oh, we have a winner. Yes, like that. See it? See how different that is? Do it again. Okay, that you did it. That's all right. Just do it a couple of times and let it go. Go ahead. Do it again. Good. Do it again. Yes, wrist time. That was wrist. Go ahead, do it again. Yes. Yes. See how different it is? How much easier it is? Okay, keep practicing that. You're still using your wrist. You're killing me. Oh, now you're not. See how different it is? Your wife just had the same epiphany. Now, when I use my arm and not my wrist, wow, it actually works. How you doing, boss?
Okay, gang, if you could grab your cones and come on over. Come on in real quick. We're going to go inside in a second, but it's been a while since Eric and I had a class this big, so we apologize if we couldn't spend as much time with each one of you, but I can say that's about as much advancement or improvement as we've seen of a group in a long time, okay? That fundamental tick tock, getting that rhythm and that, you know, accelerate to a hard stop. Practice it in your backyard. If you've got fly line at home or a fly rod at home, just go out in the grass, not the pavement, okay? And get a couple of tennis balls or soccer cones or whatever you've got and practice that. Sometimes I do it even before I get in the water, okay? Just to, if I haven't fished for 3 or 4 weeks, I want to get that rhythm back before I go presenting a fly to the fish, okay? So you guys did great. Don't be discouraged. Nobody gets this the first time out. It just doesn't happen. It's counterintuitive, but it's like anything else, golf, tennis, chess, baseball, basketball, you practice.
And if you guys are wristers, and those of you know who you are,
we have wristers?
Oh my gosh.
Oh my goodness.
So a lot of, if you're using bait casters or you're bass fishing, you're used to doing this or you're used to doing this. I'm not kidding you, either get a strap and strap the back of the fly rod to your arm, or get, you know when you break your wrist and you get those hard casts that have the hard pieces that go right here, get one of those, put them on, you won't use your wrist anymore. And you'll know the difference between what's happening with the line and what's not. Our wristers had an epiphany today, and then they went right back to using their wrists. So we'll see what happens with that.
Well, and you know, the other thing that I think I said it to Rick, our filmography guy over there, but I'll tell you, okay? Casting is personal. You're all gonna develop a style, okay? Rick commented that I kind of cast a little bit like at a sidearm. That's my style, that's what I do. But I also, my son commented one time, he said, Dad, why are you casting above your head? Well, we were fishing in a river surrounded by willows, and I was trying to keep my fly out of the willows, but so I was using my whole arm. But the rod tip was still only going 14 feet, and it was still using the rhythm. So that fundamental, whether you're doing it sidearm, crossways, wrong arm, is a fundamental, okay? And you'll develop your own style. I don't care if you use your wrist, your forearm, your whole arm, your whole body. Accelerate to a stop, accelerate to a stop, tick tock, right? We can go inside and finish up.
You're, if you're, well, So like I, like Jeff, I have a bad shoulder. So I cast sidearm almost all the time. Plus I spend a lot of time fishing in the ocean. So, and when with wind, if you, the lower you can get that rod and that line, the better off you are against wind. So if your wrist is, or your arm is getting tired, then yes, you're casting wrong. Just simply because you're either using too much energy, and you're in the wrist case, you're popping your wrist. So that's gonna hurt. That's gonna start to hurt almost immediately, especially if you're older. But as far as that goes, you know, you, like Jeff said, there's no right or wrong way to do it. It's just a matter of what's comfortable for you and what, you know, like if you have a bad shoulder, maybe you broke your elbow a long time ago, you know, whatever the case may be. It's just one of those things. Thank you, sir.
Does anybody have questions? Some days are going to be better than other days, but when you're out on the water fishing, if you're having a bad day, remember where you are, right? Okay, you're surrounded by beautiful scenery, you're standing in a river, you're having a great time, and maybe the fish aren't biting that day, okay? Don't quit, don't give up, go out the next time, give it another shot. He asked a great question, you know, does it change from summer, winter, spring, fall, shade, sun? The answer is yes, okay? When you're fishing for trout in a river, you know, the river's this deep or however deep it is, it's probably clear, and even if you can't see the fish, I can assure you they can see you. If it's in the morning and there's a shadow, you know, maybe there's a big overhanging rock or bush, it's much more likely for a trout to be sitting in that shadow than it is anywhere else, because they're hiding from predators just like any other piece of wildlife, and they don't want to be out there in the exposure in the sun. They're hiding. Now, if there's a hatch on and the sun's out and they might be out in the middle of the river and you're going to see them rising like crazy, and that happens, not often, but it happens. And then the sun's moving across the sky and now the shadows are coming from the other side, and now maybe those trout are hunkered down over on that bank over there. Okay, or under a tree that's overhanging, okay, or behind a rock. But yeah, they're going to be in a different place all the time. There are places I have fished dozens and dozens and dozens of times. I've stood in exactly the same spot. And sometimes the fish is right there and sometimes it's not. Sometimes it's over there, sometimes it's over there. They move, okay? One of the things, maybe you mentioned this, Eric, I don't know, but when you go to get in the water, okay, don't go tromping into the water. Stop, look, okay? You may be walking into a fish. Look and see where they are, okay? And even maybe hide behind a bush and look and see where they are, because if you can see them, I'll guarantee they can see you.
And guys, trout don't like to exert energy when they're feeding or when they're resting, right? Remember we talked about the oxygen level and all of that? If they're gonna be sitting in still water waiting for things to come to them, just like we do. We order a pizza. I don't go get the pizza, that's silly, right? I'm gonna wait for the pizza to come to me, right? Fish are the exact same way. They're opportunity ambush predators. They eat anything and everything, including themselves, okay? So they're gonna sit behind rocks, they're gonna sit on banks, they're gonna sit in still water between fast water and still water, what we call seams, right? And there's all kinds of literature out there that you guys can learn about. We even have some back in the back about where they sit and why they sit there. But they're gonna be exerting as little energy as possible until they have to exert energy to eat.
Ben asked a great question outside. He asked, you know, how long do you leave your fly sit on the water? And I thought he was talking about on the river, and he meant still water. And that's a really good question. Okay, in a river, like Eric was saying, trout are, you know, they're sitting next to a rock, trying to stay out of the current, and saving their energy, and they're waiting for a fly to come down, as I mentioned earlier in the day. And they'll move out and grab it, and then they move back in. In still water, there's no current to speak of, so the trout are patrolling, and they patrol in a circle. Now, they might cover the whole body of water, they might cover a little bay or a portion of the water, but they're gonna circle around. So if you're fishing a fly on still water, you might have just missed them. So It's okay to maybe give it just a little twitch once in a while, like a grasshopper pattern would might be struggling on the water, or a moth might be struggling on the water. Give it a little action, okay? But you want to wait for them to make sure they've given them enough time to come around and see it.
Think like a bug. Okay. If you're a bug, think like a bug. If you can't swim and you're a bug that lands on the surface, what are you trying to do?
Get out of the water.
Exactly. So if there's motion or things like that, there are certain things that have motion. Flies that have wings, they land and then they get up and they land again. And then they get up and they land again. So think like the bugs that you're fishing. Okay, there's a lot, like people talk about fly line color, they talk about clothes. You see guys in like full camo, you know, all that other stuff. It depends. There are certain streams that I would fish that I'm very careful about what I wear if they're spooky. But like if I go to Bear Creek up by Morrison, they're hungry and they're stupid. I can stand there in a bright pink outfit and catch fish all day long. So really it's about, trout see the blue spectrum better than they do anything else underwater, okay? But they can't see very, there's an article that I have back there if any of you guys want it. It's a fascinating article about how trout see, okay? And trout can see shadows, see things, but they can't make them out until they're right up on them, typically, right? But you have reflection and you have things like that. So I would say, as a practice, be careful as you're approaching. Don't just skip up and go, I'm gonna catch me a 20-inch rainbow, okay? If you're wearing, you know, darker gear, that's fine. But I also wear blue stuff. I wear green stuff.
I'm wearing blue.
You are wearing blue. So it doesn't matter as much as you think. The fly line, a lot of scientific stuff's gone into fly line, and there you see some green, you see some orange, you see some brown. I don't think it's a proven thing that they see colors the way that we see colors, in the sense that they're not supposed to be there.
But they see motion.
Yes, reflection and shadow. That is what we call a hatch chart. And the hatch chart basically tells you what kind of fly, can I borrow this for a sec? What kind of fly is actually typically hatching in that particular month of the year. The weird thing about Colorado with hatches, like Jeff will attest to that, this year was crazy. It was really weird, okay? Hatches can be interrupted by weather, by temperature, by, you know, predator, whatever. They can be interrupted. It was super, super rainy this summer, right? The water was crazy dark and crazy fast. So a lot of times, the bug that you might be fishing that I might have fished for the past 5 years may not be there yet. That's why you have to pay attention to what's going on. Look at the hatch chart. There are websites out there, y'all. Websites are very good resources because they do all the hard work for you. There's one called Flycast USA, which is a great little website, and it identifies each body of water. You can click on the body of water. It'll tell you how fast it's running, how good the fishing's been, and what bugs are biting, or what bugs the fish are biting on.
Well, and keep in mind that the list that's this long of bugs that are using, that is somebody caught a fish on that bug. It's not one bug and everybody caught fish on it. Everybody caught fish on a different bug and they listed them all. So, you know, don't look at that list and go, geez, I don't think I have all those. It's okay. Pick one.
And if you see it, and like Jeff said, if you get it on your neck or you see one in the air, grab it, look at it. And you don't have to, trout aren't super smart, right? So if you have a fly that maybe is a gray instead of a green, but it looks similar to that fly pattern, that's what they call matching the hatch. If you have a fly that matches that similar enough, put it on your line and throw it out there. Because 9 times out of 10, hungry, stupid fish aren't gonna spend that much time figuring out whether or not it looks enough. If I eat it, I'm gonna get dinner. Okay, does that make sense?
We were up fishing on the Laramie River a while back and for brook trout. And the water was slow and high. And I was trying this particular pattern. It's called a Rainey's Parachute Blue Wing Olive. It's not a very big fly. It's about a size 18 hook. You see it's got that little marshmallow on top, which, by the way, bugs don't have on them. That's so you can see it. We fished with this fly pattern for 4 days and caught dozens and dozens of brook trout. So you don't have to change. I mean, aside from the ones I lost, I started out with 6. I have 2 left. If I'd have gone to Laramie River with that fly pattern, I could have fished all day long. Now, without all the rest of these that I carry around, but you don't know that until you get there.
So I'm really stubborn. And if I fish, and I typically, I'm a creature.
By the way, there's understatements, and what you just heard was a whopper, okay?
I'm a creature of habit. And so if I know that they're going to be biting on that, like there are certain hatches, to kind of answer both your guys' question, there are certain hatches that happen about the same time every year. Blue wing olive, stoneflies, drakes, you know, things like that. So, and I fish patterns that I know will work anywhere. I mean, I guide all over the country. Just because I'm in Florida and Colorado most of the time, but I've fished all over the world, and I know where, you know, what things work, and I know what works in Colorado, Wyoming, Utah, and Montana. And so I may give it a little bit longer, and I may start trying things up a little bit. I may switch I typically fish a dry drop, which is what we talked about earlier. If you want more information on that, come back and talk to us. I'll switch one or the other. I won't switch both, or I'll switch both. Like my drops are pre-tied. So I have, knowing what I think I know, and I keep a fly journal. Every fish I catch, on every bug I catch, I write down. And so I have it in a journal. And I have 50 years worth of fishing. Yeah. What month it was, what the weather was like. Like whether it's ocean or river, I keep track of everything I do. Now, you don't have to be that obsessive about it, because a lot, once again, understatement. But it helps me remember what was working. And as the temperatures and the weather gets weirder and weirder each year, it's going to be harder and harder for me to rely on that previous information, because things are just complete. I mean, it snowed on Mount Evans. It's not cold. What's it called now? Anyway, thank you. It snowed there in June, right? And there's plenty of tailwater rivers down there. They're going, oh my gosh, you know, what do we do? So it's one of those things. Ask your local fly shop. Most guys at the local fly shop are pretty cool. If you're buying flies from them, they're going to be cool to you. If they're not, turn and walk out and go the one two blocks down. Like, if they're not cooperating, you're going to always get respect and always get right advice from our guys, because we preach, just shoot them straight. If they don't want to hear it, then they can go to some place that doesn't treat them very well. Okay. But the bottom line is that, and I can tell you, if you come into our shop and you say, Eric, I'm going to fish in Wyoming, I'm not going to let you buy flies here. I'm just not gonna. I'm gonna send you to a fly shop in Wyoming, because I may think I know what happened in Wyoming by looking at my little book from 5 years ago. Completely different. Water temperature's different. Water's different. You know, the banks are different. So shop at your local fly shop, wherever you're going fishing. Ask them, as long as you're buying from. Don't go in there and go, hey, what's you know, what are they eating? And then they say, oh, stoneflies. And you go, oh, I got tons of those, bye. Don't do that. That's just rude.
Your two best friends are a local fly shop and the person fishing next to you in
exactly.
The river.
If you're not getting action on your fly within 20 minutes of staying in one place, then swap it out.
I want to make two more comments. One, oftentimes it isn't the fly, it's the size. So if you're fishing with a big fly and you're not getting any takes, try a smaller pattern, okay? I didn't pass this around, but I got a little magnetic box full of adults that are just tiny, 22, 20 size, because there are bugs that even in the adult stage are really small. And that's what a trout might take. The other thing is, if you see activity in the water, you're seeing active takes on the surface, you're just seeing blurps on the surface, or you just see a dorsal fin come out, but they're not taking what you're eating, don't wait 15 minutes or 30 minutes, switch it out, because they don't like what you're presenting, okay? Find out what it is they're eating. They're eating something. But if you have no activity at all on the water, and you're throwing a fly out there and nothing's happening, one of two things: they're not hungry, or there aren't any fish there. And that's where a fly pattern that is referred to often in general as a stimulator could be a royal wolf, something bright or red or big and ugly and something. It's a stimulator. It's to stimulate the feeding response in the trout. You're just trying to wake them up and get them to eat. And that's where having a stimulator pattern in your box is handy. But if they're not eating anything, don't just keep throwing the same fly. Try a stimulator. If they're eating actively and they're not eating your fly, you got the wrong fly.
Or it could be presentation. You could be not hitting it right. They could see you. It could be a thousand different things. Keep in mind also that trout punch above their weight when it comes to what they will eat. And I'll give you a perfect example. I was fishing the North Fork of the South Platte in July, okay? And I was fishing streamers. And streamers are bait fish patterns that you see bait fish pattern all over the place, right? Streamers my streamer I was fishing was this big. The trout I was catching were that big. Just little baby browns. But they were eating something twice their size, okay? Brown trout are also very territorial. They are the most territorial of all the trout. And if you piss them off, they're gonna eat you just because they can. Okay, so if just because nothing's happening on the surface doesn't mean you shouldn't be fishing a surface fly. Just because nothing's happening underneath the surface doesn't mean you shouldn't change up your fly and try something else. This is floating. Okay, there are probably 70 different kinds of floating.
And it's all basically chemically the same thing.
It's the same thing. So there's powder, there's liquid, and there's paste or wax. A lot of the old timers used to fish with wax, which is kind of what the paste is. Wax worked really well. I don't really know why they got away from it, because it works better than the liquid or the powder. But with the powder, what happens, what I do with it is I have the powder and I have the liquid, but I also have the spray. There's spray out there now too, believe it or not. That doesn't last very long. So what I do is in the morning, I'll dip it in the powder so that I don't have to rub it around. I'll fish it until it's not floating anymore. Then I'll pull it out, I'll put liquid on it. And all you do is you just take this little bottle and you go clip, and you put a little dot on the fly, and then you rub it into the feathers. You rub it all over the fly, okay? And usually, for whatever reason, the combination of the powder and the liquid, after a while, seem to work better than just one or the other. I don't know why. I'm a fan of Loon products, but Umqua makes it, Rio makes it, everybody makes it. And it literally is almost the exact same thing. I mean, you can spend, this is like $11. The other stuff, the Umqua stuff, is like $14, and our version of this is like $5. So, but chemically, all the liquid is pretty much the same. Loon does have a new one that they came out with called Fly Dip that is rad. It's really good, but it's also very expensive, and I don't pay full price, so don't listen to me, okay? All the liquids are the same. Most of the powders are the same. The pastes are the same, and it doesn't matter. Try whatever works for you. If for whatever reason you don't have any liquid and your dry flies are starting to sink, false casting, remember what we told you, there's no fish in the air, okay? If you see somebody that's false casting like 10 times, they're either showing off or they're drying off their fly, okay? So if you don't have any liquid and it starts to sink, just give it 5 or 6 heavy false casts and get it back in the water, okay? You know what else works is, you know that those little bags of crystals that you get that keep stuff dry when you order stuff on Amazon? If you open those and crush them up, that actually works really well as floating. I don't know why, but it does. Don't even ask me how I figured that out, because I don't remember. So, like I said, most of them are all chemically the same. Okay? Any other questions? You guys feel like you learned enough today? Guys, if you have any other questions, you want to learn about knots or bugs or anything like that, come back to the fly desk. That's where we'll be. Hopefully, we'll see all you guys soon. And if you want advice on what to buy, whether you buy it from us or not, come ask us. All right?
Hey, thanks everyone.
Yeah,
it was a pleasure. Really appreciate you coming out, and look forward to seeing you. Come by. You have questions? We've got diagrams on knots, on rig setups. We're always happy to share that stuff with you. And like I said at the beginning, we'd rather talk to you about fly fishing than do anything else. So, all right?
Thanks guys. Yeah, thank you.